Hello everyone, welcome to the episode 12 of Creative Writers and Illustrators. My name is Shyamala Sharmugasundaram and I'm going to be talking to Nandini Nair about her four new releases. She's recently released one picture book, one chapter book and two comics. So let's find out more. Hello Nandini, how have you been doing?
Hi Shyamala, I'm fine. Thank you for having me over on your very exclusive platform. Where I get to talk about my books.
So start telling us something about the new book, Sometimes Mama, Sometimes Papa. Is it something you created because a memory triggered you, or you saw something or heard something?
So, for those who haven't seen it, this is the book, Sometimes Mama, Sometimes Papa, and it's a picture book, and it's really beautifully produced and illustrated by Puffin. It's got illustrations by Upamanyu Bhattacharya. And the story is of a little girl whose parents no longer live together and how she has to grapple with the ramifications of this kind of change in the family. And the reason why I wrote it or why I thought of writing it is, funnily enough, it was not even really about parents living separately or together. It was more along the lines of the different roles that every single person in the family plays. I mean, if you look at it, a child's upbringing is rounded off, is created by the influences of a variety of people, including the people who help us in the house. You know, so these are thoughts which keep coming to me, that how when a child grows up, he or she has no memory of all the lives that have touched his or her life. And resulted in his becoming the kind of person he has. And also, of course, close of home, when you look at parenting and what parenting involves and how much of the parenting duty is kind of taken on by one and the other. And you realize that each one has a very significant role to play in the child's upbringing, in the child's personality development. So it was these thoughts that actually started me on this journey. And I should tell you also that this story, it went through so many drafts, because it began with trying to answer the question about who's doing more or what, who's more important. And along the way of writing it and polishing it and reworking it, it came to the point where you realize that parenting is an equal journey, and no child should actually be made to choose between one parent over the other. It has to be a balance. So it wasn't so much a memory or anything. It was just these questions that that come to your mind when you think about when you're bringing up a child, about all the roles that different people at some point or the other play in that child's upbringing, in molding the child's character. So that was kind of the background to the story.
What I liked about the book is that it focuses on the individuality and the strengths of every parent.
Exactly. That's I'm so glad you got it, because that was what I was trying to say. I'm not, it's not even an advocation of the fact that parents should stay together whether they want to or not. It is a question of, no matter where the parents are, the parents do bring their individual outlooks. One parent might be a very cool and calm kind of person, and the other one might be the kind who gets really excited or very nervous. And I think that both of these parents need to, their influence is necessary to create a sense of balance in the child's life. That is what sort of is my realization also along the process of thinking on this really difficult topic of parents and what they mean and how they play such an important role in a child's life.
Because this is a very challenging subject, to find the right balance, to find the right words, and to find the right approach, to celebrate a child's childhood with separated parents. And I love the dedication in your book. It says, to all the mamas and papas in the world, alone or together, you are wonderful. That is absolutely amazing.
Thank you. Because I think that a lot of parenting in today's world is not necessarily the ideal parenting that we were we read in books, where the story would begin with a mother, father, or a grandparent. It's not like that. It cannot afford to be like that because of the demands of individual ambitions, individual jobs, and all of those things. So why would a child who isn't in what is seen as normal, like we need to even question the idea of what is normal. So I believe that, you know, the kind of balancing that goes on should be reflected in the fiction. Because it is the true, like if a mother chooses to be a stay-at-home mother after she has had a child, then definitely it is something that should be talked about, because yes, it is some decision that he or she has made. Even sometimes fathers do it, like they opt to stay at home to take care of the child rather than hand the child over to someone else's care, and they do it. So I think that both the parents are involved in these decisions, and therefore even if one person is actually staying at home and doing it, it's made possible because of what the other one is doing. So if you look at it, it is definitely a joint venture. It can, you know, it can't be thought of as something which is just done by one person. You can't. I mean, they say a village you need to raise a child, but I think the two parents themselves, between them, they do bring several different villages with them, and they're both necessary for the raising of the child.
What can you tell us about the main character in this book, Kea?
So I think Kea is every child who has to, you know, again, here, the thing is that when I wrote the story, it was never with the thought of parents who are specifically divorced, because like I said, the demands of the job are such nowadays, the demands of families are often such that parents are forced to live apart whether they want to or not. It's a choice they have to make, and in many cases, even if they live in the same city, if one parent is doing, for example, a night shift, you know, a job that involves going out at night, it's basically like the child has only one parent to deal with. So the idea was to help the child, I mean, to help any children, anyone who's been in this kind of situation, to understand that it's okay, you know, you're always going to have both of them with you. So Kea is that child who would like both her parents at every parent-teacher meeting. I think all children would like it. Even if one parent is too busy to come, and it's only the one who finds the time to do it, who can do it. But the child himself, for all annual days, school days, programs, they would definitely want both parents there. So I think Kea represents a child whose desires are very simple and straightforward. The need to have her parents with her at every point of her journey, you know, when she's doing something important. And I don't want to suggest that she is being very cool with the changes in her life, but she's just being resilient, like most children would be. Going with what is there, and the questions that are raised by her classmates, you know, she has answers for it. But when it comes to a point when she really needs them, she realizes that, you know, I don't want to have to choose. Why would I want to have to choose? Because I think that in any kind of relationship, whether it's parents living apart by choice or because they have decided to separate, it's a lot of pressure on the child if they are made to choose between them.
Yes.
You know, I recall reading somewhere a judge talking about divorce cases and kind of reprimanding the parents who drag children to the court and force them to make a choice between one parent over the other. You can't do that. That's why I detest those questions which, our society thinks it's fine to ask a child, who do you like better, your mother or your father? I think it's a very unfair question, you know, because why should a child choose? So if you don't allow them to, if I don't think that they should choose at that, in that matter, you know, having to say this or that, then I think that itself is a philosophy of the book, that the child doesn't have to choose, that the child has a perfect right to say that I would like both of them with me when I'm going through some really important moments in my life.
You know, I like the way you portray Kea. She does not grumble. She does not crib about a situation or, you know, whatever situation life has given her. She's trying to make the best of what is offered to her. So as you said, her resilience.
Yeah, you look at children. You know, I think a lot of the guilt that comes with anything like this situation, a lot of it is induced by the parenting that we follow, that we think that the child is going to feel this way or that way. Most children, they get adapted to things pretty fast. And that doesn't mean that there isn't a sensitive child or a child who feels it more. Definitely there is. But I think by and large, the child just sort of, you know, swings with whatever is happening. And at some point,
Yes.
You know, says that, okay, this is what I want and this is what I don't want.
Right. So are you happy with the way the book has arrived?
Yeah, I never expected it will be this big. It was, yeah, I was really, I'd only seen it in the PDF, so you don't get an idea of the size. So I thought it was a sumptuously done book and it is really beautifully done. Like, it has all the kinds of details. I'd already loved the illustrations when I saw them in the PDF, but yeah, in on paper, and it looks really, really beautiful.
And Upamanyu has done, Bhattacharya has done a fab job with the illustrations.
Yes.
You know, they're quite different.
And, you know, Devangana also had a, Devangana also had a great role to play in the designing and the art director. So she was the one I was communicating with, and she was very, she shared with me all of the pictures at the various stages and kept updating me on what else would go into it and what was the sort of vibe she was trying for, which I really liked. So
let's start discussing your second book, the which is titled Minis Books, right? It's a part of a series. It's a third book in the series. Can you show the book?
Yeah. So this is the first book. Okay. This is Minis Money. This is the first one. And this is Minnie's Questions, the second one, and this is the latest one. But, you know, one thing I'd like to add is that I do believe, of course, any book read in the order in which they were written definitely is more enjoyable. But I think that Minnie's books can be read as standalone books also. They're each complete in themselves, you know, so you don't really need to know, you know, what happened in Minnie's Money. That does not in any way restrict your enjoyment of Minnie's books. So,
yes.
This is the third one.
Yeah, lift the first book. I would just like to share with our viewers that the first book has been chosen for the Parag on a list. Minnie's
second
Money.
One, this one.
Yeah.
No, this one.
Questions.
Minnie's Questions. Second one.
Why do you think the book made it to the list? What do you think?
So to give you a background of the books, you know, So Minnie's Money is about a 5-year-old girl who's given money for Dasara, which is like a very common practice in India. And what I focused on is what she decides to do the money, and how, you know, she decides that where the money goes, she goes. So she has some adventures. But I really like the way it ended around Diwali time, where she decides to make use of the money in a very effective way. And in Minnie's Questions, she started going to school. And here I, captured that sense of awe and admiration that every child has for their first teacher, you know, where every sentence is started by, but my miss said this or my miss says this. So, this Minnie's miss is Ritu Miss, who has told her that asking questions is the best way to learn about the world. And she asks questions and she draws attention through her questions, you know, even though she annoys her family sometimes, they're very patient with her. And they realize towards the end that her questions actually stem from a very close observation of what is happening around her. And in the process of answering these questions, the parents themselves sort of learn about what is happening. So I think that Parag took this. I mean, they liked it. I'm very happy about that. They liked it because of the portrayal of this character. I think it's very true to children of that age who have just started school and who want to do things according to what the teacher has said. And I think it's also because of the fact that it talks about a very important thing, which somehow as parents we forget, that asking questions actually helps children. You know, we are often annoyed and irritated by the questions that the child keeps asking, and we often shush them and tell them, no, not now. But I think this book, I hope it doesn't annoy parents, but I hope that it does inspire lots of children to ask lots of questions and to look about them and to think of the answers. So I think those are reasons. And I'm pretty pleased with the way the story turned out because of the way in which the mysteries are solved and the kinds of things that Minnie discovers and draws attention to during the course of asking her questions. So I suppose those are the reasons why Parag chose this.
Yeah, I think questioning is very important because it kind of leads to creativity, leads to emotional and mental growth. And it is a very essential part of one's learning.
Yeah, it helps you to articulate your thoughts on a variety of topics, and you know, it helps you to have the courage to speak up. You know, so you do find that, for example, Mini notices something in the house next door to her that the lights are not switched off, and this ties in with what her teacher has told her, that it's not right to waste electricity. So she keeps saying, like, what is wrong? Why haven't they turned off the lights? And then the next day she hears the water overflowing and she's like, how can they be wasting water? So it all ties in, and then it helps the parents realize that, okay, there is something wrong next door, and they go to investigate. So all of those things. And, you know, in the end, I really like how there's another mystery which is solved, because she's counting how many dosas are being made based on the noise that is made. And then she discovers something that's happening in the house. So I don't want to reveal too much. I'd like to leave it for the readers to read it and find out for themselves.
Yeah. So when I first saw the cover of Mini's books, I thought, after writing two mini books, which were centered around, which are realistic fiction, you have somehow managed to enter the monster universe, but that's not the case. Once you start realizing, you find that monsters appear in a very different way. So do share, what is the role monsters play in the book? What is the story all about?
So this is actually, you know, I think that these three books are very different from the usual series, because if you look at series, the children don't really grow in them. They are kind of static. They're constantly at one stage, and they just have different kinds of adventures. So I'd like to think that I have sort of, you know, opted out of that easy way, and I've actually shown Mini growing. So in the first one, she hadn't yet started going to school. In the second one, she's going to school. And in the third one, she has become a lover of books. So she's reading books. And this answers the question about what books can bring into her life. So she's actually crazy about the set of monster books, you know, which are about big little monsters. And this follows her craze to want to eat the monster food, and then how she discovers that there is what she thinks of as a monster living next door, and then how she discovers she loses her books and then finds them and discovers an unexpected friend. So, you know, that is the idea of it. But I think at the heart of it is about wanting to read. It is about all the things that books can bring into your life. And the friends and the memories and the various roles it brings into your life. And the horizons it can open up for you. You know, so that was at the heart of the, you know, idea behind it. And here I'd like to add that I'm also releasing an extra story about the big little monsters, which should go online sometime soon. Okay. You know, like an added this thing for readers. It should be online. You know, for those who are interested, I'll be putting it out on social media. So I've written a story, which is about the big little monster. And I think that children, because this is something that as a child, I would have liked to do. I would have liked to read more. So I like to think that, if I had mentioned a book in the book that the kids are reading, they would be curious to know what the stories are. So that's why I have written that. Yeah.
You know, I love the effort you take in creating the names of dishes in your books. You know, you read it earlier in The Curious Case of the Sweet and Spicy Sweet Shop, and now you've done it again. Okay, I'll just read out a few of the dishes which you created. Mish, squish, creamy churn, tooth crunches, bone crackers, thin longs, curly bits, seed burns, peel melts.
Yeah, round rounds are my favorite round rounds, and they are like spotted dotted round rounds. In fact, I think I have a recipe for this also, which is going to go up on the...
Oh, very good. Must share.
Yes, I will.
So, how do you come up with such names? They're like, I mean, you really feel like, oh, I wish these were available in a shop. I do want to taste.
See? Yeah, that's the idea behind it. No, that's why Mini is so curious about these food items. You know, I think when you get the curiosity of a child really aroused, they'll go to any lengths to learn something new. And I think as parents, that's what we are trying to do, to get them out of, to get them eager to learn and to make that learning as much fun as possible. You know, as long as they don't think it is learning and they think it's something fun, they are just going to surprise themselves and us all the time.
So you've written books for kids of all ages.
Yeah.
Right? So is that easy shifting or rather training your brain into writing, you know, for different ages? Because the vocabulary differs, the way you express yourself, the word, like, I mean, there are so many aspects to writing a book?
So what happens is, I think the idea decides what age it's going to be written for. Like when I had the idea of Minnie's Money, I just thought of a girl who's given some money and how she decides that wherever my money goes, I'll go. So that was the core idea. And I knew that this was not a, this could not be a girl who was like 8 or 10, because that age children are far smarter about money. And I knew that it couldn't be the 3 or 4 years, which would be a picture book age. So right there, you know, for me, the fact that I wanted it, the girl to have a certain kind of innocence about money and, you know, the kinds of things that money can do, right there, it decided for me that this has to be aimed at children of a certain age. So the idea itself, when I get, I know in what form I want to write it. There are other ideas which, like the Sweet and Spicy Sweet Shop, I did have an idea about what I wanted it to be about, and therefore I knew it would be a longer book. So I have a very distinct general idea. So I know how long each chapter is going to be and how much it's going to be overall. But coming to writing about it, no. Because when I'm, it's not a challenge for me, because when I'm thinking that I am writing about me, I am imagining being Minnie, I am imagining being that old. And I do understand, you know, how many of the concepts a child of that age would understand and what she would not understand. So that way, vocabulary wise, it's not a problem. I mean, I rarely have to rewrite it to dumb it down, you know, to make it easier. And even when I'm writing for older children, my attempt has always been to focus on the story, not on the flourishes that you bring into writing. Because I think for children who are not very used to reading, perhaps, you know, this might actually detract from the pleasures of reading. So I believe that the story should be the hero. And if the story is the hero, you're going to get more and more children attracted towards reading and addicted to reading, which is what I would want, rather than trying to show off, you know, what tricks I can play with language or how well I can construct a simile or a metaphor. That's not important to me. What is important is a story that appeals directly to the child. Because so even with the sweet shop book, I remember the curious case of the Sweet and Spicy sweet shop. One of the reviews which really pleased me was somebody who wrote saying that, you know, this book shows that good writing doesn't have to be complicated. And I took it as a real compliment, because that is my constant effort to make books and stories accessible to children, to create situations which are which they can easily relate to, you know, which is why I am not I write books which are set in everyday worlds, you know, the worlds that they can, that children can see, rather than outright fantasy. Right. I haven't written a fantasy novel primarily for this reason, because I'm afraid that it might, I mean, I enjoy fantasy myself, but I'm not sure how many children would. And I like to think that a story which presents them with opportunities which could actually occur in their own lives is far more appealing and exciting for a child, you know, to think that, hey, this can happen to me, rather than talk about, you know, a table which flies or something which talks to you, which it's just not going to happen. So that's why even with Minnie's books, you know, I wanted it to be about books, because I wanted, instead of, you know, talking about actual monsters, I wanted it to be about her reaction to these monsters, because that is something very realistic.
Yeah. So you also have two comics which have recently come out right now. They are in the ebook yes. format, available on Amar Chitra Katha's site, ACK site.
Yes, they are on the they are on the ACK app right now. And one is Aruna Asaf Ali. So basically, this project was about freedom fighters, you know, female women freedom fighters. So the two titles which are out right now are Aruna Asaf Ali and Durga Bai Deshmukh. These are the two that are out, and I hope sometime soon, in fact, they are going to come out as an actual collection of, you know, the, in proper hard copy. But right now, yes, for those who do have access to the Amar Chitra Katha app, you can read these two stories there.
So, writing a comic book is a totally different format, right? I mean, you have to use limited words, and you also have the illustration to express yourself, right? Yes. And you have to find the right mix to, you know, get the book in place. So tell us a bit about this process of writing a comic book.
So to begin with, because you're writing about a real person, you know, a lot of research is involved, which, you know, you put in a lot of research, and then comes the difficult part where you pick out the incidents which you are going to put into the story. So you think of what it is about this person that you want readers to know. You know, what image do you want to have? So, for example, with Aruna Asaf Ali, I was really impressed by my reading of her life, that she spent over 1.5-2 years underground, you know, fighting from the underground. And I found that astonishingly brave of her, because it meant being away from her husband. It meant that she would have no access to proper healthcare. It meant that she was always in danger of being arrested and put into prison or any of those things. So I chose to focus on that. I chose to focus on the fact that at a time when it was believed that your identity was kind of linked to that of your husband, you know, she created her own very, very strong identity as someone who was ready to fight, and someone who was not seduced by the power and the glory that could come with government appointments that could be given to people in high places. So that is one part. Similarly with Durga Bhai Deshmukh, I mean, she was really amazing because of the kind of service she put in for the downtrodden of the country and how much she helped people. So that is one part, which is a big thing that, you know, when you're writing a comic like this, because you don't have the freedom or the space to write too many, you pick the most appropriate and the most interesting incidents. The second part is when you actually sit down to write, because like you said, you have to create a very sparse and a very very bare bones of the text. You have to think of the dialogues that you put in, and you also have to visualize what this incident is going to look like, because you're also providing the visual notes to the illustrator. So which means that, because, you know, you've done the research, so you know where this place is, you know what kind of clothes they are wearing, you know what they're doing. So a whole lot of these things have to come into play when you're doing this. So it means that you can't afford to really mess up. So you have to be really careful. Your dialogues can't be very difficult, because, you know, if you have really big, fat, chunky dialogues, it can actually detract from the narrative, and children might not want to read it. So you keep it to the minimum. And you make sure that each panel, like even within a page, how many panels go into each page is a decision that you make. So you could choose to have just two panels, big ones, because you want to draw attention to an important landmark event in that character's life. Or you choose to have many small ones because you want to show the various aspects of that that person's life. So all of it is, it is very, very different from say writing a mini book or writing a middle grade novel, because over there you're putting your thoughts on the paper, you are focused on getting the atmosphere right, you're focused on getting the character right. Here, especially because it's a historical figure, you do have a historical figure, but also you have to make sure that you aren't making any outright errors or doing anything wrong in your representation of them, along with all of the other things, keeping in mind, you know, the interest factor for the readers, the visual factor, you know, making it as dramatic as possible so that, you know, it leaves an impact on the reader.
So in terms of time and effort, is it easy to write a comic book? I mean, I know the research, whether it's a comic book or a proper middle grade or a young adult, you know, that the amount of effort you do in for any format, it's huge. You know, you will finally take only a bit of it for your story. But how is it? Is it easy when compared to creating a middle grade or a young adult book? What is a typical word length of the text in a comic?
So the word length isn't much. You know, the word length isn't much, which is why everything has to count. Every word has to count. So I would say that, see, since I have done historical biographies already in the proper, you know, like a book format for Mango, you know, Lakshmibai and Shivaji. So I did put in the research and everything. And even there I was torn, you know, between the kinds of incidents that I had to put in and between deciding what should go in and what shouldn't. I think both of them have their own different challenges. When you're writing a book, you do have the freedom, you know, the word limit, you know, that you have to write it in this much, and you have to convey a certain kind of information to the readers. When you are writing in the comic book format, I think the challenge lies in really paring down the text to the basic and using that basic minimum to create a certain impact. Mm-hmm. You know, because you cannot afford to have too much in the other thing. So yes, it involves a lot of rewriting. I mean, I do go through several drafts of the storyboard or the graphic, whatever you call it, before I finalize. And even after that, you know, there's, because you're not just telling them what happened, you are also giving a historical context. See, if you're talking about the the Government Act of India in 1919, what it was, when you're saying the Quit India Movement, you know, you have to either give a little footnote about what it was, or you have to explain it in the course of the narration what it was, which is something you don't have to do when you're writing a full book, because right there you say that Mahatma Gandhi and others decided that it was time to end this, and so they launched the book. So you have the freedom of longer narrative there, whereas here either your pictures have to convey it or you have to resort to a footnote. I'm not a big fan of lots of footnotes because I think it detracts from the reading experience, and I'm not sure how many children will want to pause and look at it. I myself wouldn't want to, and I wouldn't want to inflict that on children. So which means that it has to come in an organic way in the conversations that people talk about, so that it's interesting. So you have two characters, instead of saying that Gandhiji decided to launch this, you say that, oh, you know, we have heard that Gandhiji is starting something new and he's calling it this. So this way it requires a lot of creative thinking, you know, to convey this information.
Right. You also have two more books coming out in this series?
Three more. So there are three more which are going to come out. I don't know when, but yeah, it is happening. And
so these two comics are right now in the ebook format, and they will soon be launched, hopefully,
yes.
in the print format,
yes.
Right? So we've come to the end of the session. Are there any quick thoughts about your latest books? I mean, pick each book and talk about it.
Okay, so I would say that this is perfect for children for parents who want to talk about families to their children, you know, to talk about how parents are always there, because children do sometimes, it's always nice to be reassured by the parents. So I think this makes for a very nice and very cozy kind of bedtime read. I really like the kind of colors that they have brought into it. So this makes for a good bedtime read for children of any age. Again, even though it's a picture book, I think even older children can enjoy it. Reading it with their parents. The mini books, you know, I'm very fond of, because I think that they act like a bridge between children who have got used to reading picture books on their own or having picture books read out to them. I think when they're ready for a longer period of concentration, these are perfect. At the same time, when a child is ready to launch out as a reader on his or her own, these are perfect because each chapter is hardly 500 words, you know. So at the same time, it gives them a sense of high that they have managed to read a book, which is the perfect thing to set them on the path to reaching for more books and becoming readers for life. So for that reason, I think, you know, and I like the fact that all of these books are color the story books, you know, which is a very, I think, innovative. Yes. So this is a picture of the monsters, and you have the freedom given to you by the publishers where it says color the story. You can just pick up your crayons or color pencils and color them and create your own little narration with that. So I think for that reason, these are perfect for, newly emergent readers. You know, and I think Mini is a character, is someone who I find her very inspiring. I call her my mighty Mini because she's just unstoppable. She just does what she wants to do, and she does it in such a cool and calm way, which I really envy. Because she seems to know what she wants far better than her family knows or guesses. Yeah. You know, so yeah, those are my thoughts.
So thank you so much, Nandini, for joining me here this evening.
Thank you, Shamla.
Thank you. See you.
Yeah.
Bye.
Yeah. Bye. Bye.